Hi, I'm Paul. In this tutorial, we'll look together at Chopin's Scherzo No. 2, and I'll make practice suggestions as we go along, which I hope you'll find helpful. Chopin's Scherzo No. 2 is, perhaps like much of his music, autobiographic. It's a great work of expression and contrast. Schumann likened this scherzo to a poem by the British poet Byron, who was a leader of the 19th century Romantic movement, describing the scherzo as overflowing with tenderness, boldness, love, and anger. A pupil of Chopin said the sotto voce opening was a question, and the second phrase the answer. Scherzo 2 is a single movement that takes around 11 minutes to play. It's usually a score of 16 pages of around 20 or so sections. Many of these sections are repeated with tiny changes, so there's not so much new material to learn as might first appear on paper. You'll be glad to know the most dramatic, lightning quick passages are in fact comfortable to play. So, you'll possibly have a pleasant surprise when you find yourself rattling them off without the anticipated difficulty, if you approach your practice in a certain way. So, let's begin. You might find it helpful to associate a colour to describe the character and mood of each contrasting section. Warm colours red, orange, and yellow can express a range of feelings from warmth and comfort to anger and hostility. Cool colours, blue, green and violet, are often described as calm, but can also bring to mind feelings of sadness or indifference. As we go through this tutorial, I've added transparent colours to the score, which I hope will express the mood of each practice section. The sotto voce opening is without pedal. It's an anxious question that appears as an echo from far away, when all the notes are heard clearly, played on the fingertips rather than legato, and to some extent blurred, it takes on a watery texture. This question gets repeated over and over throughout the scherzo, and it's one of those musical occasions when we need to try and make each repetition identical rather than change it in some way as we might normally do. So we need to decide on the speed, volume and touch and keep to it until the end. A good place to start the scherzo is to practice this short figure over and over until your hand remembers the feel of it, the weight of the wrist and the movement of the fingers. To a beginner, this might seem easy to play, but to an advanced pianist, it is very difficult. Strange, but true. In the opening section, we have the contrast of an anxious question and, if you will, a bold or perhaps even angry reply. So we let the music summon up the feelings as we play in performance, but in the day-to-day behind-the-scenes practice, we can just play everything quietly in a relaxed way. Many of you will know this scherzo from your favourite historically significant recording. So there's a temptation when you learn the work to play with the memory of the rhythm you are familiar with, rather than to start from scratch and count the note values as you play. This opening section is made up of all sorts of long and short note and rest values side by side, so I'd like to encourage you to spend a while practicing with the beat. If you counted three beats to a bar at the traditional performance tempo, you'd soon get out of breath very quickly, but at a slower practice tempo, you can just about count three beats to a bar. At performance tempo, we generally just get a feel for the rhythmical pulse of the first strong beat of the bar. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3,
Now, we start to move quickly. Practice covering the notes in chords using the thumb to pivot the hand to the next position as it makes its way from the top to the middle of the keyboard. A short chromatic figure appears twice. The second is quieter than the first and has a slight writ. The difficulty is mainly in making the first piano and the second appreciably pianissimo, so practice them side by side. Which leads us into a section you might think of as having the mood of warm colours of early summer. It's marked animated and is often played either moderate to quick. It's built of long phrases which gently rise and fall and gradually crescendo as the tension builds towards the end of the section. It's the first episode of poetry, of melody in the scherzo, so contrasts with what came before and what follows on. Thank you. Unless you have very large hands with long fingers, you'll need to connect the notes of the arpeggio accompaniment by occasionally releasing the hand from the bottom note and repositioning the hand in order to reach the top notes. In a way, we might play a traditional waltz if written in chords. As we pedal throughout, this makes not a bit of difference to the musical effect. I'll demonstrate a way of practicing which makes this section comfortable to play, and you might be surprised to hear just how close this and other sections later in the scherzo are to a waltz. Covering the chord position will make your arpeggios confident and accurate. I'll play a few bars of the arpeggio accompaniment first, thinking of three distinct beats to the bar. And then again, thinking more about the first strong beat. When you practice both ways, you'll not only hear but feel the difference between the two approaches. With all the attention focused on singing out the beautiful right-hand melody in two voices, we could unintentionally lose the best part of the bass voice, which is a shame as it can sing out too and make a trio of voices. It's also good practice to play the bass notes alone as a melody using just the fifth finger of the left hand. The black notes are thin and so is the fifth finger, so we need to practice landing confidently on the keys. I suggest you practice with a little more weight on the bass notes than you might otherwise do in performance. It's to get fine control of the left hand in such a way you can find just the right point to let the bass note sing without obscuring the singing right hand melody. Once you can do this exercise, you'll have fun re-listening to your favourite recordings to see how the bass voice sings in the shadows. And we are led into a contrasting section, perhaps best described in Schumann's words as bold. To me, I hear water in the wide arpeggio, so imagine blue. We can group the right hand notes into intervals. The more confident we are about anticipating the interval shape, the more this passage and similar can be executed with force, confidence, accuracy, and clarity at speed. The tail end of this section can be played in several ways, with one hand or by using both hands and crossing over, which gives the feeling of a little more predictability in terms of accuracy at high speed. Try both ways and choose the way you prefer. As mentioned, the scherzo has a number of repetitions with minor changes as they reappear, such as in the following examples. I won't repeat the material in full, as we are not aiming to make the repetitions particularly different from each other. Around the middle of the scherzo, the tension is abruptly released into a lyrical section with a mood of tranquility evoking, perhaps for Chopin, melancholic feelings of longing for something seemingly far out of reach. These sections repeat the second time more forcefully. There's a short waltz-like theme in between, but let's look at it afterwards, as instead, if you don't feel quite ready to play the whole scherzo, why not play these two beautiful sections run together, something like this. Thank you. We are gently eased out of the peaceful mood. We can practice as a waltz, grouping the accompanying notes into chord shapes. Notice there are two voices in the right hand. We can think of this section as the left hand accompanying both a singer and an instrumentalist in the right hand. As an exercise in finger control, practice bringing out the top voice, then swap and bring out the lower voice. In performance, the top voice usually gets picked out the most. In the following section, the right hand twists and turns. There's a lot of notes played very quickly without a break. One way to practice is to aim for target notes. Target notes keep complex passages like this together. Target notes help balance the hand in motion. In slow practice, prolong the target notes on the beat. Practice the left hand, as we have done previously, as a waltz. Put both hands together, keeping the target notes, then you're almost there. The runs up and down might sound difficult, but they are quite straightforward and comfortable if you practice the hand positions as chords up and down the keyboard in a relaxed way. The follow-on section is dark, dramatic, fast and furious. Practice by grouping notes in chords. You can be gentle and enjoy the mysterious cascade of harmonies in your slow practice. What follows doesn't sound anything like a waltz in performance, but at a less agitated, relaxed tempo, it does and can be practiced as we have done previously. As we continue, we build tension dramatically in performance, but plenty of slow, relaxed practice is needed, and there's nothing too demanding for the hands despite the way it might look and sound. Thank you. The following bravura section is usually played exceedingly quickly in concert performances. We can, once again, practice as if it was a waltz. One of the hardest sections in the scherzo follows on because it's usually played very fast and the hands expand and contract quickly as they dash back and forth. The difficulty lessens as the tempo relaxes. It's a section requiring a lot of work if you aim not to splice octaves in your performance. We arrive full circle to the final repetition of the opening. It's not an identical repetition, but there are strong similarities. When the lyrical section reappears towards the end of the section, it transforms. It's especially useful to practice the accompaniment as chords to reach the faster tempos with confidence. The following section will be familiar to you, but halfway through it takes off in a new direction. Same practice suggestions apply. Thank you. We're in the home straight now. Another bravura passage, usually taken at a very fast tempo. So practice in a gentle way, just passing the chords back and forth. The following section leads us almost to the end. It doesn't have to be played at a very fast tempo, as its purpose is to create an atmosphere of anticipation for the closing section. So hold back a little at the end of the climb upwards. The final section is best practiced in chord positions. In truth, the final chord needs great care in respect of hitting the right note in the heat of the moment. Musically speaking, the final chords don't need to be rushed to be effective, and that's worth remembering if you intend to bring the work to an audience in concert. To sum up, if this scherzo is a dream work for you, if you feel ready, I'd like to encourage you to play it. We can learn a great deal from tackling longer piano works in both technical terms as well as holding together and unifying the sections of a larger work with interpretation. The scherzo is a type of musical play without words. You invent the characters and colours with your imagination. Never be discouraged if you can't reach the faster tempos. Play at your own pace. Above all, with expression and passion. Thanks for watching. Please stay safe and well.